And welcome again, everyone, to today's webinar. I am Ramesh Mani, and today we have a very distinguished guest speaker. Lisa Brousseau is a renowned respiratory protection expert, a certified industrial hygienist. She has spent her career as an academic researcher and educator at the University of Minnesota and the University of Illinois Chicago. Her research is focused on respiratory protection, biological aerosols, and worker protection in healthcare and other settings. She holds a master's and a science doctorate from the Harvard University School of Public Health. A bit about me, I am the global product manager for the port account respirator fit tester products at TSI. I have many years' experience with specialized health and safety technology products and solutions. We also have Josh Schultz, marketing specialist, who will be also on this webinar, will be supporting us during the question and answer section. So in today's webinar, Lisa will initially speak for the first two topic items here. I will speak on the third item, and then we will have the Q&A session for the remainder of the webinar for about 10 to 15 minutes. You may submit questions at any time during the webinar, through the chat and Q&A box that you have. We will answer these questions at the end. Any questions we cannot get to, we will follow up post-webinar as quickly as possible. I will now turn it over to Lisa.
Hello?
Yes, hello, Lisa. Are you there?
Yes, I somehow got disconnected, but I'm now back.
Oh, okay.
And I apologize for that.
Thank you, and we are just at your section, so I was just going through the intro, and you're ready to take it away. Thank you, Lisa.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Ramesh, and I apologize for the minor technical glitch there. I would like to thank TSI, Ramesh in particular, but all of TSI for inviting me to participate in this webinar. I've been working, as he said, for most of my career on improving employee health outcomes for exposures to biological aerosols in general and infectious respiratory organisms in particular. I'm hopeful that this information will help you make better decisions for worker protection during this pandemic. It's important, I think, to understand the traditional definitions of transmission modes, disease transmission. I won't be talking a lot today about contact transmission, but this mode involves the transfer, usually by hands, from a contaminated source to your mucous membrane. There isn't a lot of direct evidence for contact transmission of infectious respiratory diseases, but I don't think we can rule this out as a possible mode. Droplet transmission is usually defined as large droplets being propelled onto the face and mucous membranes. So it doesn't involve inhalation, but forceful propulsion into the mouth, nose, and eyes. Some recent modeling suggests that droplets are not a particularly important mode of transmission for aerosols generated from humans. And in general, there is little direct evidence actually for droplet transmission. Airborne transmission is the only mode that involves inhalation, but it is limited to exposure that is far from the source and is thought to be fairly rare. Tuberculosis and measles are the classic examples often given for airborne transmission diseases. I don't think we can necessarily rule out airborne transmission of COVID-19, especially when we consider the data for its viability in air, which I'm going to discuss in a little bit. So as you can see, there is really no place in these first three modes, which encompass the traditional infection control paradigm for inhalation of particles near the source. That's a new mode of transmission that I've been trying to add to the paradigm for the last 20 years with limited but some success. And I will talk more about this particular mode of transmission going forward. I should state, however, that applying the precautionary approach is appropriate in this case for an organism we know little about and suggest that we should assume all forms of transmission are possible. The traditional paradigm, as I just described, for particles in particular, addresses just these two modes, droplet and airborne. So a source is thought to generate primarily only large droplets, most of which are thought to fall almost immediately to the ground, but some of which might be propelled into your face or mouth or nose or eyes. It's thought that someone located 3 to 6 feet beyond the source will not experience any droplet spray, although some CDC guidelines do indicate that range might be longer, up to 10 feet. Airborne transmission, as I said, is also considered fairly rare and to occur only at a distance. And this is the only mode of transmission where inhalation is considered. It's thought that it occurs because some of the larger droplets will evaporate to form droplet nuclei, which are then dispersed and can be inhaled by someone located far away. And as I mentioned, there are just a few, a very rare number of diseases that are thought to be airborne. So traditionally, we draw the difference between droplets and droplet nuclei at about 5 microns, although their sources are vary a lot on where exactly you should draw the line. So what I'm going to talk about right now is aerosol generation. So this classic paradigm is based on data and studies that are now more than 70 years out of date. They don't reflect our current understanding of how aerosols are created, what happens to them after they're created, and how they're inhaled. An aerosol is basically a particle suspended in air. Dr. Jones, who's now at the University of Utah, and I worked with a graphic artist several years ago to describe in relatively simple terms what happens over time after an aerosol is generated by a cough or a sneeze. But I should also mention that aerosols are generated from people breathing and talking and singing and any sort of activity like that, is in addition to coughs and sneezes. When such an aerosol is generated, it contains a range of particle sizes. So it's not just all large droplets. Some are large, some are small. So someone standing nearby may experience that droplet spray transmission, but they will also be surrounded by many small particles that are considered inhalable, meaning you can inhale them into your respiratory system where they will deposit. Most of the particles in this aerosol will not immediately fall to the ground. The larger ones can remain suspended for several minutes, and the smaller ones for many minutes and even hours. There will be evaporation, as described in the traditional paradigm, which decreases the overall size distribution of the aerosol. But it does not create droplets that turn into droplet nuclei that only transmit disease by inhalation at a long distance. You can have inhalation nearby, and that's what this first figure is showing you. In the second figure, this shows what happens after some time. So some of these larger particles will have settled and the smaller ones will continue to disperse. The person close to the source will continue to be exposed to inhalable smaller particles. And if the virus remains viable in air and the dose that is received elicits infection, then the disease could commence for that second person. As you can see, the person further from the source has no exposure at this second point in time. But some point later, with more time, many of the larger particles will have deposited, while the smaller ones will have dispersed throughout the space. And this, I should note that these figures assume negligible air currents in the room, what aerosol scientists refer to as still air. With air currents, there will be more and quicker dispersion of all particles throughout the room. So in this figure, we're showing that the smaller particles have been dispersed into the area of person C, who's standing further away, who is now at risk of infection from inhalation, again, if the organism has remained viable and an infectious dose is received. So thus, I've proposed that we need a new infection control paradigm that includes inhalation of aerosols at close range in addition to droplet and airborne transmission of particles. It should be noted that if airborne transmission is possible, I've added a little statement about this at the lower right corner, then aerosol transmission is also possible. So if an organism remains viable long enough to cause infection at a distance, meaning in airborne particles, then that organism will clearly be viable at close range. So contrary to the droplet airborne dichotomy, small particles can be generated by a source. They can remain suspended in the air near that source, and they can be inhaled by someone located near the source within 3 to 6 feet. There's been a lot of research in the last 10 or 20 years that has shown that breathing, talking, coughing, and sneezing all generate small particles from both healthy and infected individuals. So to establish biological plausibility for a particular organism, that it could be transmitted by aerosol, close-range inhalation of aerosols, we have to satisfy three conditions. First, we need to demonstrate that aerosols can be generated at the source, in this case, an infectious person. Second, the organism has to remain viable in air along the pathway from that source to the receptor. And third, we have to demonstrate that the inhaled or in part impacted aerosol particles must be able to access a cellular receptor. Again, Dr. Jones and I wrote a paper back in 2015 where we described these criteria in some detail, and I'm now going to highlight our key points and apply our approach to COVID-19. So we proposed that data must be available, and that the kind of data that would be available could help you establish either a weak, a moderate, or a strong level of evidence for each of those three conditions I just outlined. I'll review what we know so far, and I'm going to add some information to what I outlined in an article that I published back in March on the University of Minnesota Center for Infectious Disease Research and Policy website. So this is informed by some more recent data. With respect to aerosol generation, studies have shown that COVID-19 virus is present and it's viable in human nasal, throat, and sputum samples before and as symptoms develop through day 7. A very recent study demonstrated that COVID-19 can be transmitted via air from infected to non-infected ferrets. And the ferret is a good animal model in terms of elucidating influenza transmission. Macaques that were infected with SARS-CoV-2, the COVID-19 virus, showed different disease outcomes depending on the manner of exposure. Eye exposure caused mild interstitial pneumonia, surprisingly, and positive nasal and throat samples from days 1 to 7. The intratracheal route caused weight loss and also these positive nasal and throat swabs, as well as positive anal swabs. But the intragastric route caused no disease. We do have some evidence of SARS-CoV-2 viral RNA from human-generated aerosols through the results of aerosol samples in healthcare settings, but what we are missing is direct evidence of SARS-CoV-2 in human-generated aerosols, but I believe those data will be forthcoming. Missing that final piece of information, I deem the quality of evidence supporting aerosol generation to be moderate for COVID-19 at this point. We now have several studies, With respect to viability in the environment, we now have several studies that show that SARS-CoV-2 survives for short periods of time on porous surfaces, but that it can survive on smooth surfaces for long periods of time. And we have a very recent study that shows survival in air up to 16 hours. I'm going to talk about those data in the next slide. The virus survives in viral transport medium, which is used to do environmental studies, at 39 degrees Fahrenheit up to 14 days, and only 5 minutes at 160 Fahrenheit. A very recent study also showed some amount of inoculum remained on the outer layer of the surgical mask up to day 7. Taking all those data together, I deem the quality of data with respect to environmental viability to be strong. This is the study I mentioned about aerosol transmission or viability in air. This shows the survival curve of SARS-CoV-2 particles, which were about 2 to 3 microns at 23°C or 73 degrees Fahrenheit and 53% relative humidity, which is not that different from the air and relative humidity that we traditionally that traditionally occurs in many buildings. And this was characterized by the authors as remarkably flat and did not yield a biological half-life. They also looked at the virions under electron microscope 10 minutes into the experiment and then 16 hours later. And they noticed that the appearance had not significantly changed from the pre-aerosolized condition. The authors concluded that COVID-19 infected individuals have capacity to produce viral bioaerosols that may be infectious for long periods of time after shedding. Now, yes, I agree, there are some differences in lab assessments of survival and the real world, but I think these data are suggestive of an organism that is fairly hardy as an aerosol, more so than SARS, MERS, or influenza. And finally, with respect to access to target tissues and cellular receptors, studies have found that COVID-19 virus initiates infection in the respiratory system, but other organs and tissues may also be impacted. Like the SARS virus, SARS-CoV, the COVID-19 organism receptor is the angiotensin converting enzyme 2, or ACE2, which is found predominantly in the lower respiratory tract and with only limited distribution in the upper respiratory system. Macaques and ferrets show a similar infection regime as humans, and a recent study with macaques showed differences in disease outcomes for younger versus older animals. And finally, we have evidence of aerosol transmission, epidemiologic evidence in family clusters and buses, restaurants, meetings, funerals, choir practices, et cetera. And in some of these, there might even be evidence of airborne transmission or longer range transmission further from the source. At this point, I deem the quality of the evidence with respect to the access to target tissues to be moderate to strong. So Dr. Jones and I proposed a table that would help you identify the level of concern for aerosol transmission, which combines the risk group of the organism. In this case, COVID-19 is a risk group 3 organism similar to SARS, and the sum of the weight of evidence for the 3 criteria, which I described, which in this case gives you an overall weight of 7 to 8. Any organism that falls in the darker boxes would be considered to have a high level of concern for aerosol transmission. We calculated the weight of evidence for several other organisms, including influenza, norovirus, TB, SARS, and Ebola, just for illustration. As you can see, COVID-19 falls into a level of concern that's commensurate with tuberculosis and SARS. I think aerosol transmission would explain the rapid person-to-person transmission we are seeing for COVID-19. An unusual feature of COVID-19 appears to be the amount of asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic transmission taking place. If these are playing an important role in this pandemic, this would support as well, I believe, aerosol transmission via small particles emitted during talking or breathing rather than droplet transmission from symptomatic coughing, sneezing individuals. Virologic analysis of a small group of patients with mild symptoms showed very high virus titers in nasal, sputum, and throat samples soon after infection, and shedding started on day 1 and continued through day 5. This is a very different picture from SARS, where infection takes 7 to 10 days to peak, and the viral RNA concentrations are much lower during viral shedding. I could easily spend another 20 minutes talking about respirators versus surgical masks, but I will simply say that the latter do not protect the wearer from inhaling infectious particles. We should be doing our best to recommend and put into place source and pathway controls for all workers, including those in healthcare. Talk a little bit about respirators. With respect to caring for suspected or confirmed COVID-19 patients, the CDC recommends an N95 filtering facepiece respirator. I would suggest that if N95 respirators are not available, any other filter designation, PR99-100, will give you similar protection. While there is some concern about exhalation valves because they may emit particles, I suspect this is a small risk. And if my choice were a respirator with an exhalation valve or a surgical mask, which is not a personal protective piece of equipment, the respirator would be my choice. Filtering facepiece respirators can be donned up to 5 to 10 times before they become less likely to sit well, They are not designed to be cleaned or reused indefinitely. Given the problems with filtering face feed supplies, I've been encouraging organizations to consider giving every healthcare worker an elastomeric respirator, which would resolve all of the problems with supply, since these kinds of respirators can be reused indefinitely, are easy to clean and disinfect, and are much easier to fit well to the face. And the filter cartridges are replaceable if necessary, but they will last a long time in the healthcare environment. CDC recommends filtering face piece respirators for aerosol generating procedures, but as I noted earlier, I think a respirator with a higher protection factor should be used for these types of exposures. And this could be a full face piece elastomeric respirator or a parity or purifying respirator, both of which are pictured here. A PAPR has some advantages in offering cooling, especially when you're wearing a lot of other PPE, and the loose-fitting hood doesn't require fit testing. But the disadvantages of that kind of respirator are that in more complex cleaning and maintenance, including battery charging. For respirators with tight-fitting face pieces, fit testing is very important. Every person has different facial dimensions. It's not possible to predict which respirator will fit an individual. Half-face piece respirators leak around the nose and under the chin, and filtering face piece respirators require some training to properly don. I recommend quantitative fit testing because it's more reliable, and the newer instruments can be used as a training tool to illustrate best fitting practices. And so with that, I'm going to turn this presentation over to Ramesh, who will talk more about fit testing.
Thank you, Lisa, for your valuable and timely insights on the science behind the mechanisms of transmission that are likely the causes behind this devastating spread of COVID-19. Respiratory protection is clearly the last line of defense, and many of you in attendance today are living through this right now, and we thank you for all your hard work. All indications point that this situation going on right now may continue for a while longer, maybe at lower intensity than right now, but there is also the possibility of second waves. So being prepared is critical at this time. I will cover the basics of how healthcare workers and others can maximize their protection and be best prepared for this pandemic amid all the numerous challenges as well that we are all facing. So as Lisa discussed briefly, there are several types of respirators, not just the N95s, but N95s by far are the most commonly used. And so let's take a little bit of a closer look. There are three performance factors to an N95. The first is the filter efficiency itself. That's the 95 rating that tells you what percentage of particles the filter can trap in its fibers. And that too, it's for the most penetrating particles. So 95 is the worst case for the most penetrating particles. Coronavirus sizes seem to average between at around 0.125 microns, and N95s are designed to be able to trap easily the 95% of those. Filter efficiency will vary by manufacturer, even if they are rated at the same 95 level. So the NIOSH certification is critical. That's point number one. Point number two is the quality of the fit. As Lisa explained, that is critical. Good fitting N95s minimize the leakages around the sides of the face piece, not just the ones, not the particles that penetrate through the fabric. So that's the critical part, that the quality of the fit factor, or simply referred to as the fit, that measures how good the face seal is achieved, that minimizes the leakage. And finally, a third factor for the respirator to be effective, even if you have got one and two covered, you also need to properly wear it, correct donning, and to wear it for the entire duration of the exposure. Many common errors occur, which include the wrong placement of the strap, not doing a proper user seal check, or improper removal and disposal. All of these are things that can be covered during training. So Lisa has briefly described that there are two types of fit testing, qualitative and quantitative. Qualitative is a subjective test. The test does not actually measure the amount of leakage. Whether a respirator can pass or fail a qualitative test is simply based on the person detecting, sensing the leakage of the substance into your face piece. So the human ability to sense is quite limited, and qualitative relies on this ability. So it takes also a good level of training in order to administer the qualitative fit test correctly. It's easy to get qualitative done wrong. And you cannot afford that during COVID-19 pandemic. It's a very manual way of doing the tests, which are disliked by test administrators and employees alike. During COVID-19, some healthcare and other workers may also be needing the full face respirators, which provide the higher level of protection, and qualitative cannot fit test those. Quantitative fit test uses a machine to measure the actual amount of leakage into the face piece, does not rely on the person's sense of taste, smell, and the underlying technology in these machines are based on OSHA-approved methods, the most common one of these being the ambient aerosol condensation nuclei counting method, simply referred to as the PortaCount. These machines, the quantitative machines like the PortaCount, they generate a number known as the fit factor, which is a direct result of conducting the fit test. It's a measure made by the instrument taken during the simulated set of exercises known as the fit test. The number itself is a ratio of the challenge aerosol outside the respirator divided by the challenge aerosol inside that leaks inside during the fit test. Here is what is the minimum required fit test scores for each type of respirator. The higher your scores, the better your protection. New fit test protocols were recently approved by OSHA in September of last year. So there is a 2.5 minute quantitative fit test, which has fewer exercises and shortened exercise durations. Many of you are already familiar with this, as we covered in our previous webinars. These new OSHA protocol, the newly approved one, please note, is only usable with the quantitative instrument. You cannot use that if you're doing a qualitative type of fit test. A quick side-by-side comparison of the exercises and the durations between the qualitative method and this new 2.5 minute fit test. So we are all witnessing all the challenges that are being faced by not just our healthcare workers, but other workers as well, including first responders, emergency, medical service people. And many of these challenges are not just within respiratory protection, but if we take a look within respiratory protection areas, we are dealing with an acute shortage of the N95s. There are inherent challenges within N95s, even when they are available. And there are acute time and resource constraints in the companies that are trying to get the employees trained and prepared and fit tested in time as quickly as possible. Now, these challenges are not by any means only restricted to or limited to healthcare workers, but they are the ones who are most immediately impacted. Now, other industries may have their own unique challenges. We will go over some of these challenges in the next slides, and I'll cover quickly how some of the features within the PortaCount can help you address these challenges, not just during the test, but even before the test. So the N95 shortage topic, central to a pandemic preparedness is the accessibility to personal protective equipment, including respirators. Unfortunately, we are not in that situation right now, where we think that about 11 to 12 million healthcare workers may be expected to use respiratory protection during COVID-19. And even though manufacturers are rapidly expanding their production, and we've also tapped into the strategic supply, it looks like the production levels to reach the needs will take some time. So CDC has developed some or recommendations for optimization strategies. Many of you are familiar with that. If not, you can refer back to some of the links here. And other organizations also have similar guidelines. Essentially, it comes down to conserving the limited supply of the N95s, keeping it for the most critical types of workers, or switching to the elastomerics and reusables. And then, of course, also looking at how you can extend the wear of these N95s. When there is a surge type of situation, you will be likely also facing far more workers who would require respiratory protection, and this will further compound some of these N95 challenges. On the topic of fit testing with the N95s, OSHA has a temporary guidance in order to conserve the N95 during the shortage only. It suggests that you could switch to the qualitative if you need to conserve N95s. Please note that the OSHA guidance does also provide some discretion on the annual fit test, but you should not think that that applies to initial fit tests, which are still mandatory and highly important to make sure your workers are protected. So during COVID-19, respirators from the stockpile are being deployed to healthcare facilities. You're also seeing many unknown makes and models that have just been developed. And they, you know, N95s pose challenges on their own. The performance of some of these new ones may be unknown and will require refit testing. But in general, with all N95s, there are, with all the makes and models, the areas that are the biggest problem areas, as many of you are aware, are on the bridge of the nose, the cheek of the chin. These are the places where the biggest leakages happen. And, you know, beyond these, you have to be aware that N95s come in many sizes and styles, and they have varying instructions provided by the various manufacturers. You know, all these sizes are probably not even standardized across models. The new makes from the stockpiles may actually come with very, you know, few sizes. For example, during H1N1, many of the stockpile came all with the same size. So you have to try to get that to fit to your workers, who clearly will not all be easily fitted to that. Beyond that, you know, you also come in multiple styles, all the various shapes that you see there. So long as it's a NIOSH approved and fit tested, the style does not matter in terms of providing the protection. So it's critical, though, that it has to be NIOSH approved for the rating, and that you do a thorough fit test on them. Then the style should not matter. The manufacturer instructions for donning and doffing, you know, are brand and model specific, and they must be followed. Training is mandatory, and especially with these N95s, training is usually done at the same time that your fit testing takes place. During SARS, healthcare workers did get the PPE, but many of them still got infected, and it was found later on that this was during the by them auto-exposing themselves by incorrectly removing after their shift was done. So this can be critically addressed with the proper training. So the port account's real-time fit check feature will really, you know, help you zoom in to the right ballpark of the type of respirator that you need before you actually jump into a fit test. This is an invaluable tool with which you can learn. The workers can learn. They can evaluate, try, play with, make adjustments in real time to see what a difference it makes on where the fit actually comes out to be really a very solid fit. The focus sometimes, you know, goes into the fit testing rather than in training. And I want to stress that during this pandemic, training should be a very high priority in addition to just the fit testing. So this valuable tool, the fit checking tool, can be very invaluable for you. Quickly, just how does this work? You know, you give them this tool, it gives you the gauge, and you can have your workers, you know, get instant feedback, and this will help them, you know, learn and then also be able to score very high marks on the fit tests when they do get to that stage. So this is kind of a very valuable training tool right before fit testing that can be very, very useful during the pandemic. Beyond that, you know, there is some mention of just-in-time training that many of you might be looking to do for your employees, you know, where you may have training that was probably never intended for such a large number of your workers and you need to get them trained, this could be that tool that could help you at scale conduct that type of training. So as the known suppliers are getting stretched thin, many of the new unknown suppliers and resellers are jumping into this market. As we spoke, you know, the performance of some of their filtering face pieces may be not transparent. Quickly validate their performance, like I spoke before with this real-time fit check tool in the port account. In fact, we have some of our port account customers in hospitals recently just did exactly that to reject some unknown brands and ratings of respirators that help them protect their workers as well as save themselves a lot of money. During the pandemic, many organizations, of course, will also face acute time and expert administrator constraints in making sure all the aspects of the program are, you know, conducted. It is critical to conduct the program thoroughly, even during a pandemic, because it's more than just a fit test, even though that sometimes becomes the big topic. There's a lot more emphasis on, you know, continuation of the policies and maintaining everybody's training and ensuring that, you know, your people are adequately protected. So the respiratory program may have many elements. And in fact, during a pandemic, there will be additional elements that fall under the program that may be specific only to pandemics. And these would add even more burdens on some of your or some of your administrators. Using the port account will improve your overall respiratory protection program, including some of the elements just unique to the pandemic preparedness in multiple ways. It increases and optimizes your overall program efficiency and throughput. It provides training. You can test any and all types of respirators with a single instrument. It is technologically up to date, so you can get up and running easily and quickly, especially with the OSHA-approved 2.5-minute fit test. This could be a lifesaver. We've covered this in the previous webinars specifically on the FastFit. There are multiple elements of value that the FastFit protocol provides. But during this pandemic, the main element in here is how much it can improve your worker safety and save you lots of time given the higher throughput that you have to deal with. So the compliance aspect is less of the value right now. It's all about safety and doing it quickly. We've covered this before, but just to give you a quick idea of the time savings here compared to qualitative, which could take a total of 23 to 25 minutes if you include all the pre-step activities. With the new FastFit protocol, each person will take a total of 7.5 minutes. That's it. So in addition to that, you also save other elements of time, which are shown in the bottom chart there on all the prep activities and all the other steps that you need to do, which none of those apply to when you're doing the test with an instrument. A quick real-world scenario, if you were to do 100 employees with the N95 fit testing, quality will take you 38 hours. Size and models were chosen, and they've already done all the other comfort assessments, and that the qualitative test actually was done right and done right the first time. So given all of that, there is a tremendous time-saving aspect to going with the port account. And fit testing filtering face pieces with the port account allows you to spend less time doing the actual fit testing and spend more time on the training and mask selection. That is actually something that is a intangible savings that you get. And then, of course, you can be assured of getting the consistent fit every time. Quantitative testing allows you to have a more focused and economically efficient respirator inventory, because you can more easily identify the poor fitting respirators and focus only on the ones that work best for your staff, given all the constraints. During the crisis, having a smooth automated record keeping and tools are critical as well. In this environment of shortage of expertise, the port account automates a lot of the steps, and you can get your staff up and running and build their skill set to keep you and your organization at its highest levels. There are features in the port account, such as the video animations, that again provides more automation. You don't have to tie up people doing a lot of training when the instrument can provide the guidance with the very useful animations and walk them through the testing. Finally, there's a feature known as the group fit testing, where you can have one administrator run four instruments all at the same time and run it all from the same screen and basically gain a lot of efficiency that way. To round up, the port account fit tester can help you maximize your safety. It eliminates guesswork and subjectivity, which is critical for your worker safety. You can see when it fits, how it fits. You cannot do that with qualitative, so this is a great learning tool. You can know when the mask fits and when it does not, even before you actually do a fit test. It eliminates a lot of repeat work. And if your test fails, you can immediately test another mask with quantitative. With qualitative, you'll have to restart everything from the start. It reduces overall burden on the administrators. It lets the machine do most of the work, unlike the labor-intensive qualitative method. You can quantify your results and get documentation also automated. So to recap, this COVID-19 might be one of the greatest challenges of our time. It's like a perfect storm. It seems to be spreading very rapidly via the multiple modes that Lisa covered. And many of our institutions and systems seem to be kind of caught flat-footed. We have lots of resource and other challenges. Many of you are already using the port account as the product manager for the port account. And on behalf of TSI, I am proud to serve you. And I want to thank you for attending this webinar. Qualitative users who are attending from multiple industries, now is the time for you to make the switch. As time becomes an ever more precious commodity during this pandemic, you can get support in your organization to actually make the switch now to maximize your safety. You may not just need N95s. PAPR facilities may also have a N95 backup program. So you may want to get the one instrument that can do everything and be fully prepared. As you deal with some of the new respirators that I spoke about, you can assure you're truly getting the safety your workers deserve by getting them numerically, fit tested with the port account. And TSI, even during the crisis here, we have done large implementations at many healthcare facilities, and we are ready to help you. Our specialists are trained and ready to conduct training for you so that you can get up and running right after that. Now I will turn it over to the Q&A session for Josh to take us through.
Thanks, Ramesh and Lisa. Lots of great information there. Ramesh, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Great, just checking. Okay, there's a lot of great questions here. Actually, there's way too many for us to get to, but I'll try to touch on some of the topics that seem to be most prevalent. I guess one question for you, Lisa, is that we have a lot of questions about, with aerosol, this transmission, your thoughts on these fabric masks that people are wearing in public and the protection they may provide, and maybe the topic of being overconfident in that protection if the transmission of this is maybe more widely dispersed than we may have known before.
Yes. Josh, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I did publish a second article on this University of Minnesota SIDRAP website that I will direct people to, and we can share the link to that later. Where I talked about the differences between cloth masks, surgical masks, and respirators, both as source control and as personal protective equipment. And my conclusion at the end of that article was that cloth masks really will do very little in terms of either stopping the emission, preventing the emission of particles, especially smaller particles, or protecting you from inhaling smaller particles, or generally particles at all. Most of them are very, very poor filter efficiency, and they generally do not fit. So I'm not in favor of recommending the use of cloth masks for that reason in particular, but I'm also not in favor of the use of cloth masks because I believe it provides a sort of sense of false security that people will stop isolating and they will stop social distancing, which is really, those are the only things that have been shown to be effective at preventing transmission for this during this pandemic.
Okay. Another question we're seeing here is, has the risk been underestimated of aerosols traveling through air conditioning or HVAC systems within buildings? And that's for you, Lisa. Lisa, are you there?
Well, Lisa, maybe
I'm here now. Sorry.
Lost. Okay.
Can you hear me?
Did
sorry,
you hear that?
Josh,
can you repeat that question, please, Josh?
Yes, for sure. So one of the other questions we've been seeing a little bit about is, have we been underestimating the risk of COVID spreading by aerosol through either air conditioning or HVAC systems within buildings?
You know, I've been asked that question before, and I don't think that that's the case. But I, you know, as I said earlier, we can't really rule out any modes of transmission, but we're not seeing transmission epidemiologically at distances that would suggest HVAC or ventilation system transmission. We are seeing it mostly in clusters, you know, where people are close together and where there may be many people close together. So the epidemiology suggests that that isn't a likely form of transmission, but the fact that it is viable in air for lengthy periods of time, it may be simply that it is too diluted at the point that it's transmitted, the particles are transmitted through a ventilation system for anyone to get an infectious dose. And it's really the higher concentrations that you encounter in small clusters where there's lots of particles that, and that would also argue for aerosol, aerosol generating procedures being more risky, which has also been shown to be true for SARS and MERS. So I regard the HVAC systems and ventilation system transmission as a low risk, not a no risk, but a very low risk.
Okay, thanks for the answer. Ramesh, I have a question for you that seems to be out there a little bit, and that's the question of the port account instrument decontamination and the use of it on, you know, worker after worker, and is there a risk there. I know that we had some material available on that. Did you want to address that and maybe where
sure.
they can find that information?
Mm-hmm. Yes. The twin tubes in the port account are under negative pressure. So the air that flows is not going to ever flow back to the next person. There is an app note for this. We can certainly send that out. And if customers are still concerned, they don't need to be, but we do supply spare tube assemblies that they can purchase and switch out during their testing. Maybe not necessary for each one, but they could do it as per their company guidelines.
Great. Lisa, I have another question for you that seems to be coming up a lot too, and that is the question of, I think that a lot of people with this respirator shortage may be getting N95s from China and other places where maybe they don't have, they might be the same type of mask but don't have NIOSH approval or whatever. One of them, you know, some of them are called KN95s. What are your thoughts on those? Are they in this time of shortage okay to use? Are they being used? What's the position on those? Or do you know?
I don't know a lot about those, but I do believe that either NIOSH or CDC or both did publish a list of acceptable respirators from other, other countries and the certifications that they have to undergo. But I have heard anecdotally that there are some respirators with ear loops in particular. And, a respirator with an ear loop just gives me, makes me hesitate to call it a respirator because there's really no way to adjust the fit of a respirator if it has ear loops. So that would be a concern. The issue is both, does the filter work as well as can you fit it? And so hopefully the certification has satisfied the filter issues, but it's a little harder to guarantee that you're going to have fit unless you actually test that with real people.
Okay. And on the same topic, somewhat on masks and substitutes for maybe what's generally used, we've had a couple questions also on why aren't full or half face APRs or elastomeric masks being recommended for healthcare workers, or maybe they are. What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I don't know why they're not, because I think they would be a very good solution. As I said, especially in the time of short supplies, and when we're resorting to things like decontamination and multiple uses of an N95 filtering face piece respirator, which wasn't really designed for many, many donnings and doffings, an elastomeric respirator, either half face or full face piece, maybe full face is better because of eye exposure, is a great solution. And in fact, there was an Institute of Medicine report a few years ago about elastomeric respirators suggesting that they would be the best thing for us to be purchasing and including in the stockpile, such that every healthcare worker could have one. I do not know why they are not being pushed more by NIOSH, by CDC, by respirator manufacturers. I suspect there are limited supplies, but at the same time, this should be at the top of our list of things we should be recommending for healthcare workers and for other essential workers as well.
Okay, great. A question that was coming up with you, Ramesh, is on exhalation of air from the instrument. Is there a HEPA filter within the port account that air goes through?
Yes, the answer is yes. There are actually two HEPA filters that the air that exits the port account has to go through. And the HEPA filters, as you know, they block out upwards of 99.9% of any of the harmful virus particles. So yes, the answer is yes.
Okay, great. Here's one on healthcare workers, Lisa. The question is, they're curious about your opinion on COVID infections with healthcare workers. With healthcare workers wearing, lots of PPE for this, how are so many getting affected? Is it improper use? Is it incorrect use? Is it long-distance transmission of COVID aerosols? Or what are the factors, or how is this getting around the PPE that healthcare workers so diligently wear?
Well, I think what I'm seeing with a lot of healthcare workers is that they're not being given respirators. They're wearing surgical masks. A surgical mask is not a personal protective. It's not personal protective equipment. At best, a surgical mask is something you might put on a patient to prevent the emission of large particles. But because this is an aerosol transmissible disease, or very likely to be, surgical masks do not prevent the emission of small particles, and they do not prevent the inhalation of small particles. So I suspect that when we return to some of the epidemiology, we will see that it isn't just a lot of personal protective equipment or the incorrect wearing of a lot of personal protective equipment, but that it is the lack of the right kind of personal protective equipment, and in particular, respirators, that are causing a lot of healthcare worker infections.
And I would add to that, Josh, even though this is for Lisa, but probably the lack of proper training for the workers who maybe even if they did get the respirator, they probably did not get sufficient training on how to correctly wear them. And maybe they in the mode that people are in, that is probably a factor as well.
Yeah. I also might add that, you know, we're worried about an infectious dose, right? We don't exactly know what the infectious dose is for this particular organism, but by aerosol, the infectious dose for influenza is actually pretty low. So I would suspect it's also a fairly low infectious dose by aerosol for COVID-19. Infectious dose, you know, the filtering face piece respirator or half face piece respirator has a protection factor of 10. That means it minimizes outside concentration by a factor of 10 in comparison to the inside. It minimizes inside in comparison to outside by a factor of 10. It's true we do a fit factor of 100, but what we expect is that the best you'll get when you're wearing it, especially if you're wearing with a lot of other personal protective equipment over long periods of time, is that you may not get that 100 all the time. So we build in a safety factor. A tenfold reduction may not be good enough. And that's why I'm suggesting something with a greater protection factor for aerosol generating procedures. That 10 may not be good enough when you're exposed to high concentrations of viral particles, small inhalable ones. And so what we're looking for is a protection factor that assures that you're going to get a very low infectious dose when you're exposed at very high concentrations. You can get high concentrations by working with many patients, for example, working over long periods of time with patients who have symptoms, and not just during aerosol-generating procedures. So there's another step that adds to my expectations for the epidemiology. Eventually, we'll find that those people who are infected had very high concentrations of exposure, aerosol exposure, and very low protection from them.
Great, Lisa. It looks like we're running up against time pretty quick. I know, Ramesh, you had a few things to close out with. There's so many questions and too many for us to answer online today, so we'll go through those. And Ramesh, did you want to comment on that, the conclusion?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, everyone. I just, first of all, wanted to thank all of you for attending in the middle of all the work that you're probably dealing with, and I want to specifically thank Lisa for making time for us and for all the people in the audience. This is very, very timely and valuable. Just for everyone attending, I just want to also say you can learn a little bit more by visiting our website, which has a lot of critical resources that we've talked about, and you may have had questions. We have it all in one spot. You can schedule a demo or talk to one of our sales specialists who can help you with even more in-depth questions. If you have large training needs, you know, we have something known as an academy, Port Account Academy, where we can train for really in-depth several hours of that. Find out more about how you can, you know, take advantage of our trade-in program, et cetera, to see how we can continue helping you. You know, and then I just, once again, you know, thank you, everybody. And at the end of this, we will send out a recording of this webinar to everyone who attended so that you can keep them and refer back to it. You can reach me with any questions. My information is over there. And I think Risa has also kindly agreed to have emails, and you may reach out to her, please do. And then finally, there is another webinar later in May coming up where some of TSI's other products can be useful for mostly research folks conducting aerosol research on the virus. That's find out more. And thank you, everybody, and hope you have a good day.